lesson this morning is from a letter that Paul wrote to the church of Philippi while he was in prison. Philippians 1, verses 12 and 30. I want you to know, brethren, beloved, that what has happened to me has actually helped to spread the gospel, so that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to everyone else that my imprisonment is for Christ. And most of the brothers and sisters, having been made confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, dare to speak the word with greater boldness and without fear. Some proclaim Christ from envy and rivalry, but others from goodwill. These proclaim Christ out of love, knowing that I have been put here for the defense of the gospel. The others proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, but intending to increase my suffering and my imprisonment. What does it matter? Just this, that Christ is proclaimed in every way, whether out of false motives or truth, and in that I rejoice. Yes, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and the help of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, this will turn out for my deliverance. It is my eager expectation and hope that I will not be put to shame in any way, but that by my speaking with all boldness, Christ will be exalted now or always in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, living in Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me. I do not know which I prefer. I am hard-pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I may share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to see you. Only, live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come to see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are in no way intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but for your salvation. And this is God's doing. For he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I am still having.
Thank you, Dennis, for sharing our scripture with us today. As I mentioned, we're in a series we started last Sunday called Habits of Happiness. We're looking at the book of Philippians, which is the most positive, the most joyful book in the Bible. One of the common mistakes we all make is we fall into the trap of what I'll call when and then thinking. When such and such happens, then I'll be happy. When I get to college, when I get married, when I have a baby, when I get a job, when my kids leave the house, then I'll be happy. When and then thinking. Last week I shared with you five laws of happiness. And one of them is that happiness, as I told the kids, is a choice. You're as happy as you choose to be. You don't go looking for happiness, we learned. You create it. And happiness, by the way, is not a goal. It is the byproduct of right thinking and right acting. To begin with today, I want to quickly describe four common barriers to happiness. Let's call them killjoys of happiness, because when any of these enter into your life, they will rob your happiness unless you're prepared for them. The first one, of course, is pain. Pain is a killjoy to happiness. It's hard to be happy and in pain at the same time. The The second killjoy is picky people. People of all kinds actually can cause you to lose your joy. They can be irritating. They can be demanding. They can be uncooperative. They can be arrogant. The third is pressure. Pressure can cause you to lose your happiness. You can have pressure, as we know, from within yourself, or you can have it around you. And the fourth killjoy to happiness is problems. As we all know, there are all kinds of problems. And if we let them, they can kill our happiness. So pain, people, pressures, and problems are all what I call the killjoys to happiness. In Philippians 1, verses 12 down to 30 that Dennis read, Paul talks about all four of these killjoys. Through him, we have an example of how to be happy no matter what's going on in your life. Now, I want to remind you that Paul, when he writes to the Philippians, is in prison in Rome. In fact, he's been in and out of prison for the last 4 years. He's spent 2 years in Caesarea on false charges, and then he's imprisoned in Rome, chained to an imperial guard 24/7. All kinds of difficulties and struggles were Paul's. If you ask me, Paul had every reason to be bitter. He had every reason to be unhappy. He had every reason to be depressed, every reason to have a pity party. But instead, he writes a book on happiness and on joy. In our passage for today, Paul covers these four different killjoys, and he talks about how he dealt with them, how he had maintained his happiness in spite of everything going in ways he didn't plan or couldn't have predicted. The key verse to this whole passage is verse 27. It says, "Live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel." In this passage, we learn how to be happy no matter what. Paul models four paths of happiness. I'm going to cover a few of those, the most important ones, I think. The first, I can be happy no matter what in my life if I look at every problem from God's point of view. You see, happy people have a larger perspective. They have a bigger world view. They see the big picture. When I don't have that big picture, when I don't see things from God's point of view, and my view is very narrow, I get discouraged. I get frustrated. I get unhappy. The reason we get unhappy in this case is because we don't see what God sees, or we refuse to see what God sees. The truth is, no matter what's going on in your life, the good, the bad, and the ugly, God is working out a plan. God is working out a plan. God even takes all of our mistakes and puts them into the plan. God can use them too. My sins? Yes. My faults? Yes. What other people do to me? Yes. God says, I can fit it all into the plan. And Paul knew this. In verse 12, he says, I want you to know, beloved, that what has happened to me has actually helped to spread the gospel. While in prison, Paul is talking to the entire court of Caesar's palace. He's chained to many of them. And there were two results of this that we know for sure. Chapter 4 will tell us that within 2 years, some of Nero's own family had become believers because Paul was a prisoner in Rome. Some of the royal family had become Christians because Paul was in prison in Rome. And second, Paul is forced, because he's in prison, to sit still, which Paul didn't do very well. But he was forced to do it, and the result was he wrote the New Testament. Almost done. I wonder which had the bigger impact, Paul being out there preaching and starting churches, or Paul sitting in prison writing Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, most of the New Testament. This is why Paul says, I want you to know, dear brothers and sisters, that even though this happened to me, being in prison, it has helped spread the good news. He says, I've got my plan, his plan to preach and start churches, but God had a bigger plan. He says, I can be happy sitting here in prison because I can see what God is doing through my problem. Let me just stop right there for a second. I want you to think of a problem that you are facing right now. What are you facing in your life right now? Get it in your mind. We all got one, at least one. Now I want you to bow your heads for just a moment for a very short prayer. And I want you to say these words in your heart. Let us pray. God, help me to see this problem I have from your perspective. Help me to see this problem with eyes of faith. Amen. Friends, anytime you have a problem and it starts getting you down, you're starting to be unhappy, you need to do what Paul does. Learn to see it from God's point of view. What is God doing here? What's the bigger picture? What's the bigger perspective? When you face the problem in faith, two things will happen. First, you'll be a witness to unbelievers. Paul says in verse 13, so that it has become known throughout the imperial guard to everyone else that my imprisonment is for Christ. And second, if you look from God's perspective in your problems, it will be an encouragement to believers, to your brothers and sisters in Christ. He says in verse 14, and most of the brothers and sisters, having been made confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, dare to speak the word with greater boldness and without fear. It's a witness to unbelievers It's an encouragement to believers. Second habit I want to talk about. I can be happy no matter what. It's when I never let others control my attitude. Paul is a good example of one who doesn't let anyone decide whether he's going to be happy or not. Paul, in the next section, talks about four kinds of people, three of which are killjoys to happiness. While he's in prison, he says, there are some people who are attacking my ministry. They slandered Paul. They judged him and criticized him. They were gossip mongers. Then there were some people, his friends, who supported his ministry. There were also some who competed with his ministry. They're trying to kick him, while he's down. And finally, there were some who were undermining his ministry. They were trying to destroy him. They were trying to rub it in. He was in prison, so they tried to make it more painful. Have you ever known someone, friends, who loves to argue, that loves conflict, that loves controversy, that loves to live the soap opera life? These people are contentious, they're divisive, they're critical. Friends, the critic's motive is usually jealousy. When people criticize something, they're usually jealous of it. Would you agree that few things rob your happiness faster than being criticized? When you're criticized at work, or you're criticized by friends, where they're criticized at church, wow. Your stomach churns. Why? Well, I think it's pretty simple. We all want to be loved. We want approval. We want everybody to like us. But let me give you a little happiness hint here. I don't need other people's approval to be happy. I don't need other people's permission to be happy. Friends, you're as happy as you choose to be. If you're unhappy, that's your choice. But you don't have to depend on other people's approval in order to be happy. If you haven't got their approval now, you're probably not going to get it. And you're going to be miserable if you try to live with the approval of everybody else. I want you to see Paul's attitude. He says, I'm in prison. I'm already down. And these guys are kicking me while I'm down. Critics, conspirators, and competitors. They're trying to get at me. Verse 18. Here's Paul's attitude. What does it matter? He says. Just this. That Christ is proclaimed in every way, whether out of false motives or true, and in that I rejoice. I'm not going to let other people control my attitude. There may be people criticizing me for what I'm doing. There may be people competing with me for what I'm doing. There may be people who are conspiring to make sure I fail in what I am doing. It doesn't matter. What I'm going to do is I'm going to focus on Christ, and I'm choosing to be happy. I'm not going to let anybody steal my joy. I love what verse 28 says, be fearless. Be fearless. No matter what opposes you, it will be a sign to them of their downfall, and that God is with you.
and that he will save you.
Here's the thing. If I want to stay happy, even if I'm in prison, whatever that prison may be, I look at everything that's going on in my life from God's point of view. And I realize he's going to work it all out for good. And it's worked out for the gospel. It's a witness to our believers. It's an encouragement to believers. Then I just say, no matter who the critics are and who the complainers are and who the conspirators are and who the competitors are, they're just not going to stop me from being happy. I'm going to keep my focus right. I'm going to be fearless. Jesus said it like this in Matthew 5. It's called the Beatitudes. It's the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount. He says this, "Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." Celebrate. Paul explains why you can be happy no matter what. Verse 29-30, he says, "For he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well. Since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now hear that I still have." Paul says it's a privilege to suffer when you're doing the right thing. Great is your reward in heaven. He said it's a privilege to believe in Christ, and it's a privilege to suffer with Christ and for Christ, because you're the most like Jesus when somebody nails you to the cross and someone is trying to get at you. So he says, "I am not going to let anyone rob my happiness." Paul says, "When I'm alive, my purpose is simply to serve Christ by serving people. When I die, my purpose is to be with Christ. Either way, I win." I don't want you to miss this secret, friends, because most people on this planet do. I want you to hear this secret that I'm going to tell you. The reason why most people are miserable is because they think that happiness comes from self-gratification. Maybe you think that way. If I just get more possessions, more pleasure, more position, more sex, more salary, more stuff, then I'll be happy. Doesn't work. Actually, self-gratification is not the way to happiness. The way to happiness is self-sacrifice. Paul says the reason I'm happy is because as long as I'm alive, I'm giving my life away to help others. Friends, are you doing that? Or are you living for yourself? If you're living for yourself, I can tell you right now, you're never going to be happy. Never. Because happiness does not come from status or stuff. Paul sums up his purpose in verse 21. "For me, living is Christ and dying is gain." If someone were to ask you to fill in the blank, "For me to live is blank," what word would you use? "For me to live is sports. For me to live is clothes. For me to live is to make money." For me to live is my family. There could be a lot of good things, but nothing deserves the place of for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. I want to say this. How you fill in the blank will determine your level of happiness. For me to live is Christ. There is only one answer that leads to happiness, and I want you to be honest with yourself and to settle the issue once and for all. Are you going to choose happiness?